In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. Welcome to Living Word Baptist Church, where the Word of God comes alive. Our mission is to exalt the Savior, equip the saint, evangelize the sinner, and empower the community. Our pastor and first lady are Reginald and Vanessa Fletcher. Please enjoy this recording of a portion of one of our Sunday morning services, and stay tuned at the end for general information about our exciting ministry and how you can get involved. Now, let's enter in and be blessed.
Praise God. Thank y'all. Woo! I just thank and I praise God. All the songs today. They started out the gate with joy, 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 joy. If you know me, my favorite scripture is always, again, I say rejoice. And they talked about pray for me. My mom died when I was 8 years old, but I can feel the prayers of so many that they've placed in my life. So I thank God for that. And then Beautiful Feet ministered off that song. I don't know what the name of it was, but they had some energy and some fire for the Lord. One part of it said, who has the final say-so? Jehovah! Jehovah has the final say-so. I don't know why y'all wasn't up on y'all feet, because just to know whatever we're going through, who has the final say-so? Jehovah. It's not man. It's not the preacher. It's Jehovah. So I just thank and I praise God. I stand to you before you this morning to speak. Where's James Roberts? To speak. He said, you gonna preach that? I ain't preaching. I am speaking a message for God. That's all. I'm a speaker. So let's go before the Lord in prayer. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Father God, thank you. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for each person that's in this building on today. God, we pray that you would just touch their hearts, that they may hear the word for themselves, God. We love you, we honor and praise you. In Jesus' mighty name, have your way, God. Amen. I want to thank and praise God for my husband, once again, just for allowing the women to just be available to be used by God this month. So thank you. For those that came out to hear the word this morning, thank you. Our theme this month is answering the call to love and serve. And in order to answer the call, you've got to be available. So whatever that stuff you have, if you were in Sunday school this morning, we were talking about unforgiveness. Sister Diana had an empty jar. That's how we need to come before the Lord this morning, empty, so that he can fill us up. If you would stand with me, the scripture is Luke 10, 38 through 42. Luke chapter 10. Y'all should be familiar with that. Pastor has been in Luke. No? Okay, well, Luke said the same thing that Mark said. Praise God. I was at Cracker Barrel yesterday having breakfast by myself, me and Jesus. And someone came and gave this to me. It just said, Happy Mother's Day. And I turned around and it was Shantae. And so she didn't know it was me, because y'all know I'm a little freer now. So she just hugged on me. I just said that. She said, that lady was over here by herself. I ain't by myself. Jesus right here with me. So Luke chapter 10, verse 38 through 42, I'm going to be reading it from two translations, so bear with me. The first one is the New Living Translation, Luke chapter 10, verse 38 through 42. As Jesus and the disciples continued on their way to Jerusalem, they came to a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. Her sister Mary sat at the Lord's feet, listening to what he had taught. But Martha was distracted by the big dinner she was preparing. She came to Jesus and said, "Lord, doesn't it seem unfair to you that my sister just sits here while I do all the work? Tell her to come and help me." But the Lord said to her, "My dear Martha, you are worried and upset over all these details. There is only one thing worth being concerned about. Mary has discovered it, and it will not be taken away from her." Remain standing one more time. In the Message Bible, it just kind of breaks it down a little bit more. Same scripture. As they continued their travel, Jesus entered a village. A woman by the name of Martha welcomed him and made him feel quite at home. She had a sister Mary who sat before the master, hanging on his every word that he said. But Martha was pulled away by all she had to do in the kitchen. Later, she stepped in, interrupting them. "Master, don't you care that my sister has abandoned me in the kitchen? Tell her to lend me a hand." The master said, "Martha, dear Martha, you're fussing far too much and getting yourself worked up over nothing. One thing only is essential, and Mary has chosen it. It's the main course, and it will not be taken away from her." You may be seated in God's house. So in Luke 10, 38 through 42, Jesus and his disciples are on their way to the capital city for the last time. To get there, they have to go through the village of Bethany, which is a suburb about 2 miles east of Jerusalem. Jesus had great affection for Martha, her sister Mary, and their brother Lazarus. And that's found in John chapter 11, verse 5. Jesus sent word to them that he and his disciples were coming to visit. The woman started preparing her home. Y'all know if the preacher say he coming to y'all house, y'all gonna stop doing something and gotta put away some things and maybe get some dust bunnies, you know, that kind of stuff. Yeah, the preacher coming to the house. So Martha was busy. Mary, they had to get it ready, preparing their home. But before we are so quick to judge her, Martha, we know that our own relationship with Jesus, it should be first place, right? Mary stopped and she drew herself closer to Jesus. The choir sings a song, and people have heard me talk about this. "I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you." That's probably what Mary was singing that day. Everything belongs to him. That was her cry that day. Her thoughts, her actions, and her attitude flowed out of her intimate connection with him. But as we all have discovered, this is not easy to do. Even while carrying out the Lord's work, we can lose sight of the first priority of deepening our intimacy with him. Spending time is more important than getting many things done and doing many things well. So this morning I want to look at Martha's life of service, Mary's life of worship, and the choice is yours. And before I move forward, I'm talking about Mary and Martha, but I want you to impose your own name in there. Brothers, don't check out on me. Sisters, hang in there with me, because we need to look at this scripture and again put our own self in there. We need to hear what God is saying to each of us about service and or worship. So first, looking at Martha's life of service. Martha was a servant. She was the original Paula Deen. She was Israel's answer to Betty Crocker. She was the New Testament Proverbs 31. Oh, yeah, and Martha Stewart. She was the queen of the kitchen and the rest of the house as well. Can you imagine? You probably do it. Some of y'all got y'all dinner in the oven now, and y'all been doing all the preparation and getting ready and got to get this and got to have that and lining everything up. You did it all. She was busy. She knew Jesus was coming, and she was busy. Her mission was that she wanted everybody to be satisfied with the meal that was being served that day. Not only does she intend to prepare a lavish menu, but she's going to do it in a sterile environment. She cleans the house as though there's going to be an operation in the living room. If you asked her why she went through all this trouble, she would say, if something is worth doing, y'all know that? It's worth doing well. It's worth doing well. Martha is trying to serve a dinner for 15 or more with zero help. Y'all experience that? Y'all invite folk over, you think sister got your back, and you doing it all by yourself. So she's going along and she flies past the kitchen. She see her sister sitting at Jesus' feet. Not my sister. How dare she? Don't she know we got to get this done? So that's at that moment. She probably got an attitude, y'all. She got a little salty. Yeah, she got a little salty. We cannot give Martha low scores on service, because service is what she did well. So it wasn't that. And Jesus wasn't even faltering her for her service. Because in the previous scripture in Luke chapter 10, it talks about the Good Samaritan. And the Good Samaritan dealt with who is our neighbor. Our neighbor is someone that has a need and that we're able to fulfill that need. So as Martha began, she realized and recognized that Jesus and the boys had a need. They've been traveling all day. They've been sharing the word of God here and there. So their need was they needed to be fed. They needed to be filled. And so she had the gift of hospitality. She was able to fill that need. And you know what? In that day, hospitality was taken seriously. It was so serious work. Your ability to offer hospitality said everything about how you respected the person that you were serving. So Martha was striving to put something big together to show her level of respect and love to Jesus. The difficulty, Jesus points out, was not service, but the spirit of the service. The spirit of the service. And I have a mirror up here, and I wish I could have put the big mirror up here, because a lot of times we doing stuff and we need to check ourselves to make sure our attitude is right. Because we can do stuff half-heartedly and it's not the same thing. So Jesus was, because Luke said that Martha was encumbered by serving. So she had, it was weighing on her. I'm going to do this thing, but she ain't, you know, she, her heart wasn't right. Martha, Jesus said, you are worried and distracted by many things. In essence, he was saying, calm down, take a deep breath. You can almost feel the breath leave Martha's body. But in her mind, and if it was some of us, we probably would say, well, Jesus, what had happened was, I was trying to do all this. Jesus, who gonna watch the bread and who gonna cook? Jesus, if I don't do it, it won't get done. That's what she said in her head. But Jesus already knew about that. How often do we find ourselves running so hard after God, trying so hard to please him or please others? Giving everything we have to see that the work gets done, and finding at the end of the day that the joy we should feel, the peace we should have earned, the rest we so deserve is out of reach. Rather than fulfillment, we feel only stress, frustration, and despair. Where was Martha's heart? Was it on the things of God or on the things of the earth? Where is your heart this morning? Why are you here? Is it to say, check, I did it, Jesus, I showed up. Mama told me to come, so I'm here. Where's your heart? God is looking at the heart of the matter. Research says that anxiety is produced when we care too much about the wrong things. Let me say that one more time. Anxiety is produced when we care too much about the wrong things. Anxiety is a good indicator that something is wrong. You can take a pill to lessen it and make it more bearable, but anxiety is speaking to you about the condition of your soul. Jesus was lovingly telling Martha that something was very wrong with her thinking and her soul. Martha's external behavior at first appearance was true servanthood. She was the one who put the apron on and went busy serving everybody. But her treatment of her sister soon revealed a serious defect in the servant's heart. She allowed herself to become critical and sharp-tongued. Y'all know when y'all snap off on somebody. Don't be saying, about Martha. I'm talking about y'all. She allowed herself to, in front of the guests, humiliate her sister. Her sister. And at that time, she probably, I don't care what they think. She needs to. But, ma'am, Jesus. Y'all know what I mean. The moment Martha stopped listening to Christ and made something other than him the focus of her heart and attention, her perspective became self-centered. Martha was showing an attitude of sinful pride that made her susceptible to other kinds of evil, such as anger and resentment and jealousy and a critical spirit and unkindness. All of that flared up in Martha in a matter of minutes. And you're just like, what just happened here? In a matter of minutes. The enemy wants to steal, kill, and destroy. I don't know if you've ever been at a family function and everything's going well. People laughing and having a good time. And in a matter of seconds, the enemy creeps his ugly head in and wants to destroy something. That's what happened that day. When we work hard, especially when others don't join you or notice you, do you notice yourself becoming more critical of others, more judgmental, assuming the worst of their thoughts and their motives? Why you ain't call my name today? What? I did. Pastor. Yeah, it ain't about that. Where's your heart? It's your heart condition. When Martha interrupts Jesus, instead of applauding her, Jesus gently rebukes her, telling her Mary has chosen what is better, the better part. Jesus' words in Luke 10 are incredibly freeing to those of us that's on the performance treadmill of life. If I could just do one more. No, Jesus said she has done the one thing. The one thing. So I'm saying to you this morning, it's okay to let the dishes sit in the sink. Sister Vanessa said, it's okay to leave the vacuuming and the dusting undone. It's okay. It's okay. However, however, don't be walking in the dirt. Daryl's like, what? Leave it undone. Yes, it's okay. Because so many times those are the little things that distract us. I got to do this. I got to do that. Jesus wants us to take a moment and sit at his feet. Get into the word of God. That's what's going to make the difference in our lives. It says heaven and earth will pass away. It's stuff. It is stuff. So make sure that we spend the good part, take the time to do more of being with Jesus. Martha opened her home to Jesus, but that doesn't automatically mean she opened up her heart. In her eagerness to serve Jesus, she almost missed the opportunity to know him. So that's Martha. Let me shift a little bit to Mary's life of worship. Mary may have started out serving, then as Jesus began teaching, she became magnetized to his every word. Mary knows there's plenty to do. And I know you guys may be that way too. You know there's so much to be done. And yet, Mary's unable to move except closer and closer to Jesus. She sits at his feet and she holds on to his every word. And she hears from the master. The thing is, during that day, it was improper for a woman to sit among all men. Mary didn't care. I don't care about tradition. I want to hear from Jesus. I need my heart different, Lord. So many times we come in and we leave out the same way. Jesus desires something of us different on today. So Mary knew that it was unacceptable to sit amongst all the men. She didn't care. But I just want to pose this if, parenthetically, Martha may have come in to ask Jesus to get Mary back on track because she knew that her sister wasn't supposed to be in there. That's a possibility. So she was, Jesus, tell her, come on back and hear where she's supposed to be. But Jesus, it was his invitation to come. And just like he is inviting Mary, just like he's inviting Martha, he's inviting each of us. Right. Take some time and sit at my feet. Yes, you got to get to work. Yes, you got to bake the cake. But just take some time and get into my word. Mary chose to let someone else do the serving so she could do the listening. It isn't every day that Jesus comes to your house after all. Forget that. I want to spend time with Jesus. Jesus. Somewhere in the distance, she heard her sister, Mary. She's like, look, talk to the hand. Because I'm not listening. I'm listening to Jesus. Jesus. We are called to love and to serve. After all, that's our theme, answering the call to love and serve. It is said that the sincerest form of worship is a useful life. A useful life. Is your life being useful today? But in order for our lives to be useful, we must truly be worshipful. It must be life-giving. I've got to spend time with Jesus in order to pour something out. If I just say, okay, I'm available, and you don't truly have anything to give, you've not spent any time with Jesus, your service is fruitless. Fruitless. So we want to make sure that we spend time. Jesus desires less busyness and more quality time with him. More time at his feet, getting into his word. That something more is the Lord himself. That something more is an intimate relationship with Jesus. Mary had chosen the good part, according to Luke 10:42. She had discovered the one thing needful. Sister Dana James was here on Friday and spoke a powerful word to our spirits. She talked a little bit about this one needful thing. Every morning you get up, we should be asking, Lord, what's the one needful thing that you desire that I do for you today? Because we got a whole agenda. I need to do this, I need to do this, I got to get this done. But what's the one needful thing that God wants you to do for him? And so if you don't take away anything else, what is the one needful thing that God desires for you to do each day? Mary has chosen the good part. She discovered the one needful thing, true worship and devotion of her heart and full attention to Christ. That was the higher priority than even service. And the good part she had chosen would not be taken away from her, even for the sake of something as gracious and as beneficial and meaningful as helping to prepare a meal for Jesus. Mary's humble, obedient heart was a far greater gift to Christ than Martha's well-set table. The scripture shows us that worship is the highest of all priorities for a Christian. So if you are here today and you say that you are a Christ follower, a Christian, the highest form of worship to him, the highest form of service to him is worship. Nothing, including even service rendered to Christ, is more important than listening to him and honoring him with our hearts. Remember that Jesus told the Samaritan woman, God is seeking true worshipers. That's found in John 4:23. Christ found a true worshiper in Mary. He would not affirm Martha's reprimand of her because it was Mary, not Martha, who properly understood that worship is a higher duty to Christ than service rendered on his behalf. It is a danger, even for those of us who love Christ, that we not become so concerned with doing things for him that we begin to neglect hearing from him. Never allow your service for Christ to crowd out your worship to him. The moment that our works become more important than our worship, we have misplaced priorities. Whenever we elevate good deeds over sound doctrine and true worship, we ruin the works. Doing good works for work's sake has a tendency just to exalt ourselves. Good deeds, human charity, and acts of kindness are critical. That's important. Because I want to say to you, don't leave here and say, well, I can't do nothing else the church asked me to do. That ain't what I'm saying. Because yes, we do need vacation Bible school workers, y'all. Yes, we do need Stephen ministers. Yes, they need choir members and ushers and youth workers. We need that. I'm not saying don't do anything in service. We need that. However, your heart needs to be right. Yeah. When we give to God, it needs to flow out of the overflow of worship with him. The choice is yours. The choice is yours. We often face the same struggle as Mary and Martha. We want to sit at his feet and worship, but there is just so much to be done. We hear God's call and we respond, yes, Lord, I'm today. I went to that retreat 2 weeks ago. Today, I got it, Lord. I'm gonna do it, Lord. But the phone rings or my Facebook feed pops up or I forgot to do this, Jesus. Oh, I'll be back. And so we postpone yet again our worship and our devotion time with Jesus. Don't let work become the master. Trust that it will get done because the Lord is here with us, working through us. Know that if we choose first the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness, Matthew 6:33 said, all other things shall be added unto you. Jesus saw Martha's situation. He understood her complaint. But he loved her too much to give to her what she wanted. Instead, he gave her what she needed, an invitation to draw closer to him. He sees us. He hears our cry. His invitation is for us to draw closer to him. The Lord Jesus invites us to cast our doubts, our fears, our anxiety upon him, to discover how much he really does care. He says to you this morning, trust me, my child. I have your ultimate good in mind. Jesus is calling us to choose the better part because a ministry to our spirit must supersede our ministry to others. Matthew 22:37-39, Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the greatest and most important commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. But if we get that thing turned around, we'll be burnt out. We'll be grumpy. We'll have attitudes with everybody. Because the first part says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, and your soul. That's the first part. After that, then get involved with service. But spend that time with Jesus. God wants us to allow the Holy Spirit to have access to all the hidden areas of our lives. Whether we tend to be a bit driven like Martha or more meditative like Mary, God is calling us to intimacy with Him through Jesus Christ. In closing, I have 5 brief points about intimacy with the Savior. Number 1, an intimate relationship with Jesus must be chosen. It must be chosen. We could stay or could intentionally, take time to be with Jesus. So we can stay doing what we always do, or we can choose to intentionally spend time with Him. We have to carve time out of our busy schedule to be with Him. Secondly, intimacy includes listening, hearing, and loving. Today, we cannot audibly hear Christ's voice. He speaks through us through His word. As we sit at His feet, in His word, He will direct us to the word that applies to what we're dealing with. Number 3, intimacy with Christ demands that we leave some things undone. I've already touched on that. So just got to leave some things undone to be with Him. Number 4, intimacy with God requires that we prioritize. Yep, lots to be done on my list today, but what's the one thing God desires of me first? That's number 1. And then prioritize the other things. Number 5, negative consequences result if we neglect intimacy with Christ. When we look at Mary's attitude as opposed to Martha's, Mary had a peaceful disposition. Martha was encumbered by stuff because she didn't do that one important thing for Jesus. Many of us are more likely to sit in front of the television, the computer, our cell phones, rather than at the feet of Jesus. We must take time and reevaluate how we use our time by asking, is there anyone or anything that is more important to me than Jesus? Other things may seem pressing, but there's nothing more necessary or more rewarding than spending time with the Savior. Spending time at His feet will enrich our relationship with Him and bring us a deep peace and satisfaction. Every moment with Jesus is a moment well spent. Martha was noble and a godly woman with a servant's heart and a capacity to serve. Mary was still nobler with an unusual predisposition of worship and wisdom. Both were remarkable in their own ways. If we weigh their gifts and their instincts together, they give us a wonderful example to follow. Let us diligently cultivate the best instincts of both of these extraordinary women. Shall we pray? Father God, help us. Help us, Lord, to focus on You. God, You are the author and the finisher of our faith. You are the one that allows us to breathe in and breathe out. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us for being so busy that we only take time to pray over our food, Lord. Forgive us, God, that we don't spend the time that we need to worshiping You. Time is but a vapor. We assume that we have tomorrow and the end of the day, but God, You may snatch us up at any minute. Help us, God, to daily do the one needful thing in worship to You. We love You, God. We thank You. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. Beloved, we are thankful, excited, and humbled that you decided to worship with us today. We pray this recording has been a blessing to you and that you are not the same person you were before you heard it. If you're interested in worshiping with us again, our normal Sunday morning service times begin with Sunday school for all ages starting at 9 a.m. And our Sunday morning worship and celebration begins at 10:15 a.m. We also have midweek Wednesday Bible study at two convenient times, either 12 noon or 6:30 p.m. For more information about our church and other ministries, please check out our website at www.lwbcindy.org. That's www.lwbcindy.org. Or friend us on Facebook or follow us on Twitter at lwbcindy. Beloved, we just want you to know we love you. And remember, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. May God bless you and keep you.